Now that we've looked at the idea of standard deviation and we know how to find it, let's talk about how do we use it? How do we interpret it? Well, we know that it's a measurement of variability, so obviously the bigger the number, the more variability, the smaller the number, the smaller the variability. But what is big and what is small? Is a standard deviation of 13 big or is it small? Well, I don't know. I mean, I really don't. It's really case dependent. What is the data that you're using? So to start off this conversation about how you actually use the standard deviation, let's talk about the empirical rule. And really the idea behind the empirical rule is kind of a warm-up for inferential statistics, which we will spend several chapters discussing. And the standard deviation plays a very key role in inferential statistics. Now the empirical rule is really just a rule of thumb. It's really nice approximation, and very commonly the way it's used is to help identify whether or not a particular observation may be unusual. Now, the empirical rule applies strictly to mound-shaped data. If the data does not look relatively symmetric and mound-shaped, don't use it, because the empirical rule will not work well. It will actually be very misleading. And the data obviously needs to be at least interval, which means interval or ratio. That's what at least interval means. Because remember, the measurement scales in order go nominal, ordinal, interval, ratio. So at least interval means interval or ratio. And this is what the empirical rule says. Let's get this up here. There we go. So here's my mound. What it says, first of all, is that approximately, and this approximately is important, approximately 68% of all the data is within one standard deviation of the mean. So that would be mu plus or minus sigma. I'm just going to write it sigma. It's because sigma would be the one standard deviation. Now, for working with sample data, very commonly we say, hey, we use x bar plus or minus s, and that's a really nice approximation. It's not exactly what the empirical rule is based on, but it works very well. So in this case, I'm going to have mu equal to 0, and the way this curve is drawn, sigma was equal to 1. That makes our math really nice and easy. So 0 plus or minus 1 would be negative 1, right there's negative 1, to positive 1. So what they're saying is that approximately 68% of all the data will fall within one standard deviation of the mean. That's what the empirical rule gives us. And again, it only works if the data is mound-shaped. Part two of this says approximately 95% of all the data is within two standard deviations. So I'll just write this as mu plus or minus 2 sigma. Well, because down here, sigma is equal to 1, 2 times 1 is 2, so that's 0 plus or minus 2. That would bring me from negative 2 to positive 2. And this would give me approximately 95% of all of my data. And then the last part of the empirical rule says approximately 99.7, and really we say essentially all the data is within three standard deviations, plus or minus 3 sigma. So again here, with this example of sigma being equal to 1, 0 plus or minus 3 would be negative 3 to positive 3. So within here, we say approximately 99.7 or percent, or essentially all the data. So it's really unusual in this type of mound-shaped data to see any observations beyond three standard deviations from the mean. So let's just take a really quick and simple example. Let's just suppose we have an observation X that is 3, or say 4.1. Oops, 4.4. What the heck? And in this case, sigma equals 1. So how many standard deviations is this away from the mean? Well, if I take the observation, say x, minus the mean, and divide it by the standard deviation, that would be the number of standard deviations. Think of it this way, x minus the mean is a distance. And I'm dividing it by the value of sigma, so that'll tell me how many sigmas are in this distance. Now that may seem just a little bit confusing, so let me sidetrack here for just a second. Let's suppose that something is 66 feet away, and then you're looking out there and you're seeing something else that is 36 feet away. Well, if I take 66 minus 36, I get 30 feet, right? So the distance between these two objects is 30 feet. Well, how many yards is that? Well, I know that there's 3 feet in a yard. So if I divide this by 3, I get 10. So the distance between these objects is 10 yards. Well, here, when I do this, I'm going to say the value, whatever it is k. But this is k standard deviation. See, it's exactly the same idea. It's just that the units are different. So this will tell me how many standard deviations two values are apart. Just like this tell me how many yards two points are apart. It's the exact same idea. So for here, if x was 4.4, I'd have 4.4 minus the mean, which is 0, divided by the standard deviation, which is 1. And in this case, I get my 4.4 back. That means that this observation is 4.4 standard deviations above the mean because this is positive. Well, I know that within 3 standard deviations of mean, I should have essentially all of my data. This is another almost standard deviation and a half. This is like way up here someplace. So this observation would be extremely unusual. It is way out there relative to the mean. And that is one common way to use the empirical rule. Simply figure out if the data is roughly mound shape, how many standard deviations a value is away from the mean, and then say, hey, is that unusual or not? And as a general rule of thumb, this is just general rule of thumb, we will formalize it much more later, anything beyond 2 standard deviations, that's where we typically say, hey, this is getting unusual. We would not expect that to happen. Anything less than 2 standard deviations, we say, hey, well, you know, that could have happened. It's not a big deal. Now, if I did this calculation and this was a negative, all that would tell me is that this 4.4, this original value, is below the mean. It'd be in this direction instead of be down here. So a negative here simply tells you whether you're above or below the mean. So let's apply the idea of the empirical rule now to this mound-shaped data that has a mean of 12 and a standard deviation of 2. Well, right here is 12, so that's mu. Right down the middle, there's mu. Now I have a standard deviation of 2. So I'm going to take mu plus and minus sigma, which for the first step would be 12 plus and minus 2. And that would give me, on the plus side, 14, on the minus side, 10. So that would give me 10 and 14. So I come down here to 10, out here to 14. This is one standard deviation. This is one sigma. This is one sigma away. So if I look at this, according to the empirical rule, if I actually have the data that created this, between the values 10 and 14, I would expect to see approximately 68% of all of the data. So if I actually have the data, I could simply count how many data points or data values fall between 10 and 14 and say, hey, is that about 68%? And then I would take mu plus or minus 2 sigma, go 2 standard deviations. Well, in this case, it would be 12 plus or minus 2 times 2 because the standard deviation is 4. I'm sorry, because the standard deviation is 2. That's 12 plus and minus 4. So on the lower end, I would get 8. And on the upper end, I would get 16. So come down one more standard deviation. See, here's another sigma. I'm here at 8. Go up one more standard deviation. There's 16. See, I'm 2 standard deviations above the mean. And according, again, to the empirical rule, I should have about 95% of all my data fall in there. Then again, anything outside that, once again, we'd say is unusual. And then for this last step, I would take mu plus or minus 3 sigmas, which in this case would be 12, plus or minus 3 times 2. Let me fix that real quick. That was kind of ugly. There we go. 3 times 2, that's 12, plus and minus 6, which would bring me on the low end down to 6, and on the high end up to 18. So down here is 6, up here is 18, and between these two values, we'd say there's approximately 99.7%, or essentially all of your data. There's going to be very, very few guys out here beyond these endpoints, if the data is reasonably bell-shaped and symmetric. Now again, this is, I should put another sigma in here. There we go. Now you can count the mean, 1, 2, 3 sigmas. 1, 2, 3 sigmas in the opposite direction. Now this is, again, just kind of a really brief warm-up for the idea of inferential statistics. As a general rule of thumb, we can use this idea by using that calculation I showed you later. And later we'll formalize that. That's actually called a z-score, which equals an observation minus the mean divided by sigma. It's actually referred to as a z-score. And we explore this again in a later chapter when we start getting a little bit more in-depth into some inferential statistics. But this idea can be used, along with the empirical rule, to start identifying unusual observations.